this fourth chapter starts with a very, you know, surprising statement by Lord Krishna. The fourth chapter of Bhagavad Gita is called, is known as Gyan Yoga. That is the yoga of knowledge. So here we were supposed to, listen Lord Krishna talking about the knowledge of the self, the knowledge of the self, the knowledge of consciousness, how to connect with the consciousness. But surprisingly, at the very beginning of the fourth chapter, he says something which gives rise to a question in Arjuna's mind, and from there a new topic comes out, and then we realize that it was not Lord Krishna was not actually intending to speak about the knowledge of the self. He was intending to speak about the knowledge of this personal God incarnate. You know, this is the this is one of the most authentic proof about the doctrine of incarnation. When we see any spiritual books or any spiritual text, we can only see the, you know, the supreme to be defined as a non-dual and attributeless, formless, and nameless, and which cannot be contemplated, which cannot be perceived. But here he talks about a personal God. He talks about a reality which has got shape, which has got name, which has got attributes. And, you know, and by knowing this also, one can attain the same liberation the way one can attain when they know or when they realize the non-dual self, the self which does not have any attributes or which does not have any shape or quality. So, you know, it starts like this. So let us go into the text and then we can talk about it. So the fourth chapter, Bhagavad Gita, Om Shri Paramatmane Namaha. I pray to God so that we can all understand the essence of this chapter, of this doctrine of incarnation, because this is also, you know, this is also very important for our lives. It's also very important for everybody of us, and in every age, the Lord has arrived. Lord has descended. But somehow we fail to see him. Somehow we fail to understand him. And after he is gone, then only people become aware about his presence, about his existence. And when, you know, they become aware, till that time he's already gone. He's already gone from this world. So, you know, this was an attempt by Krishna to announce to the world that there is an existence of this Lord who descends into this world, and he has got the same quality as, you know, as described in the scriptures, of having, you know, he's the omniscient, he's the omnipotent, and he's the omnipresent. Still he is in the body, and he appears, you know, he appears within the body. He does not take birth. So here the text goes, Om Shri Paramatmane Namaha, Srimad Bhagavad Gita, Atha Chaturtha Dhyayah, Jnana Yogah, Shri Bhagavan Uvacha. The Lord speaks, Ibam Vivashvatam Yogam, Proktavanam Aham Avvayam, Vivashvate Manave Prahu, Manur Iksha Kuha Pravit, Evam Parampara Praptam, Imam Raja Shrayo Vidu, Sakala Neha Mahata, Yoga Nashta Parantapa, Sa Evayam Mayatedya, Yoga Prokta Puratana, Bhaktosi Me Sakacheti, rahasyam hi taduttamam. Now in these three verses, Lord says that now I am going to talk to you about a yoga. That is, now I am going to talk to you about a knowledge which I have delivered this knowledge to the sun god, you know. So sun, after getting this knowledge from him, from me, sun, after he have received this knowledge from me, he has delivered this knowledge to his son Manu, and Manu to his son Ikshaku. And in this way, this knowledge was traveling through ages, through traditions, into these kings, and into these kings, through these kings. But through time, but in time, it got extincted. Now it's not there. Means through time, it got it lost its relevance. It became extinct, and that is why I want to talk to you about. I want to tell you about this particular yoga, and through you I want to revive this knowledge again, and I want to talk to you about this yoga because you are my devotee and you are my beloved friend, and that is why I want to talk to you about this. So when he said this, you know, when Krishna said this, that I have said this knowledge to the sun, so Arjun got very bewildered. You know, he thought that, what is this? What is he saying? How can Krishna say this knowledge to son? Krishna was just born now, maybe, you know, before 80 years, 90 years. We don't know the exact age when Krishna was, you know, delivering this message of Bhagavad Gita to Arjuna. Some people say that at that time, Krishna was 100 years. Some people say Krishna was 120 years. Some people say he was 80 years. Maybe, whatever, you know, just let us consider that Krishna was at that point, he was 100 years old. So Arjun was wondering, how can Krishna, being a 100 years old man, how can he deliver this knowledge to the son who is in this world, who is existing in this world from billions of years? And that is what, you know, Arjuna asked Krishna, that Arjun uvacha, Arjuna said, that aparam bhavatu janma param janma vivashvata kathameti dvijaniyam tomado praktavaniti. You know, Arjun was wondering, how is it possible? How is it possible that you say this knowledge, you deliver this knowledge to son, because you are just born now, maybe before 100 years, and the son is here for like billions and billions of years. We even don't know what is the exact date when he came into existence. How did you deliver this knowledge to him? So, you know, Arjuna did not understand that Krishna actually didn't want to tell him about that knowledge. Krishna wanted Arjuna to get, you know, surprised, to be wondered, to be bewildered, and ask this question: how is it possible? How is it possible that you say that you have delivered this knowledge to the son? And that is when is going to talk about this particular knowledge, which is very, very rare, which is very, very, you know, mysterious, which is not available to anybody. Like it is said that whenever an incarnation comes, very, very few people who are very close to him can actually understand his presence. Most of them don't understand who is he. But they get the fruits of his presence. They become realized. They become, you know, full of knowledge. They become full of devotion. But they are always unaware of the fact that why this is happening to them so spontaneously. Why this is happening to them so easily. Because this knowledge or devotion or, you know, any spiritual insight or spiritual depth is not so easy. One has to spend a lot of time in meditation. One has to spend a lot of time in spiritual austerity to get such kind of depths. But here, you know, just in the presence of a person, one starts to have this, you know, very deep spiritual insight, and they cannot, you know, and because it's so easy, and because it's so spontaneous, and because it's so normal, it seems so normal that they don't even wonder how it is becoming possible. and then they think that it's because of them. They think that it's because of their own qualities. It's because of their own, you know, own greatness or own spiritual, you know, strength that they have received this knowledge. But it's not so. It is because of the presence of this very huge power which descends into this world, which is known to a very, very, you know, few people, you know, people who are very close to him. And another thing is that it is only known to a person to whom this incarnation, this Lord God incarnate, or this, you know, Lord incarnate, he wants to make him known. You cannot know this on your own. You can know the self. You can know the self because self is your own nature. You can know the self, you know, with quest, with the search, with the honest, you know, with the honest quest. You can know the self, but you cannot know the Lord. You cannot know this whole doctrine of incarnation. You cannot know, or you cannot recognize this person. You cannot recognize this person unless this person wants you to recognize him. So here Krishna wants Arjuna to recognize him, that he is God. And that is why he has given this very, you know, very bizarre statement that, you know, I have saved this knowledge to some. Just imagine, you know, somebody, you know, as your friend, who may be a little bit, you know, spiritually, you know, enlightened or spiritually elevated. She's going now.
Bye.
So, you know, he may have a spiritual elevation, but you know, it is only the Lord with his wish he can know him. So it's not possible. So Krishna wanted Arjuna to be surprised. Krishna wanted Arjuna to be very, very bewildered and very, very like, you know, how is it possible? How is it possible that you have said this to Sun God? And that is when he would reveal his secret. He will reveal his, you know, this knowledge, this mystery of his appearance, mystery of his being. So this fourth chapter, you know, in the beginning of this fourth chapter, it's all about this incarnation of God. And this is one of the very important chapters. Please, you know, receive this knowledge with full faith that this happens. This happens, and this is very normal. It's not, you know, it's not any abnormal thing or paranormal thing. It's not like that. It's very normal. It has been happening in India for a long, long time, and it is going to happen, you know, again and again in this world, you know. So, you know, if you receive this knowledge with full faith, with full understanding, with full devotion and love, you will see that you can also understand this doctrine of incarnation. And in, not only that, you know, if you can understand the doctrine of incarnation, you will see, or you will meet the God who appears in every ages. This is also a fact. Okay? So, you know, Krishna has made this revelation through Bhagavad Gita to the world. But most of us don't believe this. We recite these verses, but we don't believe it. We just consider this to be something which cannot be argued or cannot be pondered over, but we don't believe it. Any person who believes this, he meets this person. He sees God, you know, in flesh and blood. God in flesh and blood. God as his own, friend, as his own father or mother or whatever, you know, in whatever way he wants God to be. God appears before him in that way. So this is very, you know, this is very, very true. So here, you know, Arjuna says, how it is possible that you are born just before like 100 years and the sun was here for like billions of years. How is it possible for you to deliver this knowledge, this knowledge of yoga to him? And then Krishna says, Sri Bhagavan Uvacha, the Lord speaks, Bahuni me vetitani janmani तव चार्जुन तन्नाहं वेद सर्वानि नतं वित्त परंतप. He says, you know Arjun, you and me have appeared in this world many, many times. See, this is also knowledge. This is also the same as the impartial, the, you know, this non-dual knowledge. This is also the same as the, you know, imperceptible, incomprehensible knowledge. But this knowledge is tangible. This knowledge is tangible. You can touch it. You can feel it. And when you feel it, you feel the same, you know, you feel the same Lord. It's like, you know, water and ice or water vapor, you know. If the shapeless, the nameless Lord or the nameless supreme being or consciousness is water vapor, so this one, you know, the Lord incarnate is ice. You can not only see him, you can touch him, you can feel him. But when you feel him, you're feeling the same water vapor. You know, here the states are different, but the constituents are the same. The substance is the same. So they're all busy. Anyway, थोड़ा चुप कीजिए, हमको हम क्लास ले रहे हैं. कैसे लगा?
आप बताइए, आप
वो बोल रहे, अब तो क्लास ले रहे हैं, बाद में बताइए. इन लोगों बोल तो जा रही हो?
बोल तो जा रही
हूँ. पानी का बोतल है क्या?
नहीं. I'm going. Bye. See you soon.
पानी का बोतल है क्या?
देखो फिर से कचरा नीचे डाल दो.
So here he says that इतना होने सोचा, इतना होने सोचा तो
हो गया, को उठाया भी नहीं.
So here he says that you see Arjun, I and you, we have come into this world, we have come into this incarnation many times, many times. Bahuni me vetitani janmani tava charjuna. I and you have come to this world many times, we have taken birth many times. Tannaham veda sarvani, in all this I remember everything. In all these births I remember each and every birth. Natam betha parantapa, but you, oh a great saint, you're a great saint, but you don't remember anything. You've forgotten everything of these past births, but I remember, you know, I remember all. And then he speaks about his appearance, he speaks about his nature. He says, ajopi san avaya atma bhutanam ishwaropi san. He says, Arjuna, though I am birthless, I don't take birth. I don't have to take birth because I am fulfilled. There's nothing, you know, left for me to take birth. I have no accomplishments left. I have no engagements. I have no responsibilities. I have no karmas. You know, the reason for taking birth are this, that either you have not completed your job. You have not completed your karmas, you have not completed your desires, you have not fulfilled your desires, or you have not, you know, attained the knowledge of the self, and that is why you are ignorant. And because you are ignorant, you can't attain that state of eternity. So you have to come back again and again to, you know, acquire this knowledge. So Krishna says, you know, there is nothing left for me. Neither am I ignorant, nor do I have any responsibilities or karmas or anything which has to be accomplished. I'm a full accomplished soul with my karmas, you know, completely over, fulfilled. And I am the knowledge. I'm the knowledge absolute. I don't have any ignorance in me at all. Ajopi san, I am the buttless avvaya atma. I am the avvaya. Avvaya means inexpandable. You know, in you cannot spend me. Like anything, you know, you have money, we have money. Like we have a lot of money, like thousands and millions of dollars. But at one point, this whole money is going to be spent. But, you know, there is some wealth which, you know, even if you spend, you know, if you, even if you spend whatever, you know, they're not going to be, they're not going to exhaust. They're always going to stay. So this is, you know, that is the thing, avvaya. You cannot spend me at all. I am infinite. Avvaya atma means I am the self. I am the infinite self. And bhutanam ishwaropi san. And I am the Lord of this whole universe. I am the Lord of this whole universe. So when I am the Lord of this whole universe, I can, you know, I can do everything without taking birth. I have that power. If there is something wrong in this world, I can fix it. I can fix it even being in my own nature, not coming into this, you know, into this realm of duality, not coming into this nature, not coming into this human form. I can just fix everything, you know, remaining in my nature. But I do come into this world. Why? Because I have love. I love you all. You know, I have this deep attraction. I have this deep attraction because I am of the nature of love. So because I am love, I cannot keep my, you know, existence, or I don't want to keep my existence, you know, separate from you. I want to come within you. I want to become one of you. And I want to, you know, I want to face each and every problems with you all, you know, shoulder to shoulder, hand to hand. And, you know, I want to be with you, everybody. Okay, and this is because I love you all, because you are my own self, you are my own soul. Ajopi san avvaya atma bhutanam ishwari ishwaropi san. Arjuna, remember this, that though I am birthless, though I am the infinite self, and though I am the Lord of this entire universe, but prakritim swamadhishtaya, but by controlling my own nature, I am of the nature of infinity. I am of the nature of everything. You know, I am omniscient. I am omnipotent. I'm omnipresent. This is my nature. I'm present everywhere. I'm the most powerful person of this world. I have all the knowledge that is existing in this world. I'm fulfilled. I'm completely fulfilled. But I control my nature. I become limited. I become small. I degrade myself. I become small. I create wants within me. I create necessities within me, because this is not because, you know, this is because not because that I have these necessities. I create these necessities because I love you. And without these necessities, I cannot come as a human being. I cannot stay within you. You cannot touch me. You cannot feel me as your own self, as your own. You cannot feel me as your brother or your friend. So that is why I have to become like you. And to become like you, I need to control myself. I need to control myself. And that is why I control my own nature, my own qualities. Ajopi san avvaya atma bhutanam ishwaropi san. Prakritim swamadhishtaya. I control my own nature. And sambhavatma mayaya. We say that the Lord incarnate is born, like on this Janmashtami day, we consider that the Lord was born today. But on Janmashtami, the Lord was not born. He appeared before us. So he says, prakritim swamadhishtaya sambhavatma mayaya. Controlling my own nature, I appear before you all. I appear before you all. How? With the help of my own maya. Maya means illusion, delusion. Now, I am the same. I am this infinite Lord. I'm this infinite Lord. I'm this buttless, deathless, formless. I'm this buttless, deathless, formless. But through Maya, I become, you know, I take birth, I die, I acquire form, I acquire qualities, I acquire all these human qualities, I acquire all these human attributes, you know, which can be attributed to a human being. I acquire all those qualities, and I appear before you. Because if I don't do this, you cannot touch me. You cannot even, you know, reach me. You cannot even comprehend me, contemplate me. Because I'm always beyond. I'm always beyond you. You cannot perceive me at all. So he says, you know, this is the doctrine of incarnation. The Lord incarnate, he does not take birth. He appears. Ajo pisan avvaya atma bhutanam ishvaro pisan. Prakritim swamadishtaya sambhavatma mayaya. We are, you know, witnessing the highest knowledge in this world. Today, now, at this point, you know, at this moment, we are witnessing the highest knowledge of this world, the rarest of the rare, the mysterious of the mystery, the mysterious of the mysterious, the secret of all secrets. Because here is a person who is saying that, you know, I am the Lord. I'm the Lord. I'm the formless. But I come into this human form only for you, because I love you. Because I love you. And, you know, is it possible for us to see him? Because we are talking about Krishna. He was born like 6,500 years ago. He was there before 6,500 years ago. Is it possible for us to connect with him? Yes. Even today, if you have the qualities of Arjuna, what was Arjuna? Who was Arjuna? Arjuna was an ardent devotee of Krishna. He was such a devotee that he was like, you know, he used to think Krishna to be his own. If you can feel God to be your own, if you, you know, we see, we comprehend, you know, this world to be our own, our relationships, our parents, our friends, our brothers and all this, you know, we think that they are our own. They are not our own. They are also human beings. They also come to this world. The only person who is our own is the Lord himself. If we can, you know, if we can consider the Lord to be that who is our own, and if we can love him, if we can have faith in him, if we can have faith in him now, if we can love him, and if we can say that, Lord, I'm yours, I love you, and I want to see you. Just close your eyes, and as if, you know, as if a child is talking to his mother. When a child talks to his mother and asks her for something, you know, the child doesn't know whether the mother can give him or not. But the child has only his mother to ask. So he asks his mother, "Oh mother, please give me this, please give me that." And the mother gives him. In the same way, if you can, you know, if you ask him, if you pray to him, if you love him, if you tell him as if he's your own, don't pray him. You don't need to make an effort to connect with him. He's within your heart. He's within your heart. Just tell him that, Lord, I want to see you. Please appear before me. You know, as if you are talking to your own self. You're talking to your own self. You will see the Lord will appear before you. And this is very true. This is very true. Even today, in this age of, you know, all impossibilities, this is the only possible thing which can happen. You know, it's the only possible thing. So just tell him. Just tell him with full faith, with full love that I want you. I want to see you. Tell him. He will see that he will appear before you. Because he is not in the heaven. He is within your heart. He is within our heart. And if you can, you know, if you can speak to him, your words will reach him. Have faith in your own words that they will reach him. They reaches him. Okay, so Krishna says, Ajo Pisan Avvaya Atma Bhutanam Ishvaro Pisan. Though I am the butless, I am the infinite self, and I am the Lord of this entire universe, Prakritim Swamadhishtaya, but I control my own nature. I control my own nature. I become small. I become like you. Sambhavatma Mayaya. I appear before you through my Maya. Through delusion. You know, though you see the Lord, though you see the Supreme Being, but you think that this is a human being. And this is because of Maya. Okay? So just pray, oh Lord, please remove your Maya. Just pray to him in this way. Oh Lord, please remove your Maya and see that he will appear before you. Please remove your Maya. That's it, you know. You don't need to say anything more. Just say, please remove your Maya and you will see that he's there. Ajo Pisan Avvaya Atma Bhutanam Ishwaro Pisan Prakritim Swamadhishtaya Sambhavatma Maya. And then, when does he come? When does he appear before us? He says, Yada Yada Idharmasya Lanir Bhavati Bharata Abhyutthanam Adharmasya Tadatmanam Srijamyaham. When does he appear? He says, Yada Yada Hi Dharmasya Klanir Bhavati Bharata. When there is, you know, when the nobility is troubled, when dharma is troubled, when truth is troubled, then only I come. That means the Lord is the friend of truth. The Lord is the friend of piousness. The Lord is the friend of dharma. The Lord is a friend of honesty, sincerity, all the good things that we have within us. He's the friend. You know, if you see in the 12th chapter, you know, in the Bhakti Yoga, you will see that the Lord talks about an ideal human being, that human being which attracts the Lord. You know, in normal terms, you know, we get attracted towards the Lord. We create ourselves in such a way, we develop ourselves in such a way so that we can have attraction, we can feel this attraction towards Lord. But in the 12th chapter, the Lord says that, you know, if you have certain qualities, then you don't need to be attracted towards me. I will be attracted towards you. And what are those qualities? These qualities are all the sattvic qualities. Adveshta sarva bhutanam maitra karuna evacha nirmamo nir ahankara sama sukha dukha shami santushta satatam yogi yatatma dhrir nishchaya mayyar pita mano buddhir yo madbhakta samipriya. So if you can become like this, you know, if you can become like this, then the Lord will be attracted to us. We don't need to go to him. Mayyar pita manor buddhi. You know, a person whose whole mind and his whole heart is surrendered to me. His whole heart and his whole mind is surrendered to me. He is my dearest and I get attracted towards him. Okay, so these are the qualities that he has talked about in the 12th chapter. And when we read this Bhakti Yoga, we'll see these qualities, you know. So here he says, Yada Yada Hi Dharmasya Planir Bhavati Bharata. When there is evil around, when there is falseness, falsehood, when there is, you know, when there is tyranny, when there is atrocities, when people are, you know, when innocent people are all suffering, and abhyutthanam adharmasya, and when this whole adharma is in its peak, when the whole evil, you know, violence, vice, when the vice is at its peak and virtue is at the lowest level, truth is at this lowest level, tadatmanam sujamyaham, then I come, then I appear. You know, when you experience this kind of, you know, if you experience this kind of situation where you being honest have been troubled, when you being sincere, when you being truthful is troubled, you know, you will see the Lord will appear for you. You don't need to wait for an age for the Lord to come. You know, it happens every time. It happens every time. Whenever truth is troubled, whenever virtue is troubled, and whenever there is advent of vice everywhere, you know, that is the time when the Lord appears. You can see him if you want to see him. But the trouble is that when we are surrounded with vice, when we are surrounded by atrocities, when we are surrounded by adversities, we forget to see the Lord. We become too much, you know, attached to the situation. We become too much attached to the situation, and we, you know, somehow we want to get out of the situation. But in that situation, if you can see, you know, the Lord has said that when the truth is troubled, the Lord appears. Did the Lord appear? You have to search him being in that situation, and you will see the Lord does appear. He is within you, and he has appeared before you. You can see him, you can talk to him, and this is very, very true. I have experienced this time and again. I've experienced this time and again. And if you can, you know, if you can also, you know, in the worst of the situations, in the worst of the situations, without getting, you know, affected by the situation, if you search him, where are you? You will find him. Because these are the words of the Lord. Yada yada hi dharmasya planir bhavati bharata abhyutthanam adharmasya tadatmanam shriyamyaham. Whenever virtue is troubled and there is an advent of vice, then I appear. And what do I do after I appear? Paritranaya sadhunam vinashaya cha duskritam. Paritranaya sadhunam. I rescue the pious. I rescue the truthful. I rescue them. And vinashaya cha duskritam. And I destroy, I destruct, I kill, I destroy the evils, the sin. And he does it, you know, he does it. If you want to see him, he does it. He does it in every day, in every situation. Whenever you are in trouble, if you are truthful, if you are in virtue, if you are in honesty, if you are in truth, you will see that the Lord appears. He destroys the sin. He destroys the sinner. He rescues you. Paritrana sadhunam vinashaya cha duskritam dharma sangsthapanarthaya sambhavami yuge yuge. Just to restore dharma, to restore truth, I come again and again in every age. And I have seen to restore dharma, to restore truth, he comes in every moment, in every day he appears. The only thing is that you have to see him. You have to have this urge to see him in every situation you face. Don't see the situation. This is that. He has said this to me. Don't go into that. Okay, I am in a bad situation. I am in a very wrong situation. I am in a very precarious situation. I'm sad. I'm sad. In that, try to see where Lord is. Because Lord said, if you are in truth, I'm going to rescue you. Paritranaya sadhunam vinashaya cha duskritam. If you are a real saint, if you're a pious human being, if you're truthful, then he's going to rescue you. And he's going to destroy the evils around you. Dharma sangsthapanarthaya sambhavami yuge yuge. And to restore dharma, restore truthfulness, I come again and again in this world. Okay? So this is very true. It's very true. Then he says, जन्म कर्म च दिव्यमेवं यो वेत्ति तत्त्वतः त्यक्त्वा देहं पुनर्जन्म नैति मामैति अर्जुन. There is a very simple way to understand him. There is a very simple way to get him. You know, you don't need to have, you know, you don't need to have a lot of austerity. You don't need to spend, you know, thousands and thousands of hours in meditation. You just need to see the essence, the purpose of the purpose of birth of this kind of people. Janma karma chame dibbamevam yo vetti tatvata. If you see, if you can understand, if you can know why the Lord comes and how the Lord comes, and what does he do? If you can see him, you know, in every situation, not in other person's life, in your own life. When you can feel him in your own life, his presence, his assistance, his help, when he comes and rescues you, if you can see him, and if you can understand that this is why he has come, because I am his devotee, I am pure, I am truthful, I am harmless, and you know, I am honest, and that is why he has come. He has come to rescue me. If I can understand this, janma karma cha dibbam evam yo vetti tatvata, if a person can understand the purpose of my appearance, and the purpose of my karma, the purpose of my activity, what happens to that person? Taktva deham punarjanma naiti ma maiti so arjuna. He, after leaving this body, he attains me. He comes and gets mixed in me, and he does not take birth again. He becomes my own self. He comes and gets mingled into my own nature. He becomes me and I become him. So this is so easy. You know, in every situation, because we all have situations where which is painful. We have situations where we fall into situations where, you know, we are helpless, we are truthful, but we have to face the burnt. In that case, don't get attached to the situation. Don't get impressed by the situation. Just try to see where the Lord is. Wait for him to appear. And he appears. And the moment he appears, just try to see, why did he appear? Try to see the purpose of his appearance. And the way he works, see the way he works, just see, follow him, follow the Lord, follow his works. That is the only way by which you are going to mingle with him forever. And you will not take part. And then he says, how can a person follow this? How can a person, who are this person who can see this happen in front of their eyes, that the person who are truthful, and how can they see them? He says, Bita raga bhayak krodha. A person who does not have any attachment to this world, who is only attached to me, whose only purpose of life is to attain me. Bita raga, who does not have any affection, any attachment to this external world. Bhaya, and who does not have any fear. Because, you know, when we fall into adversities, the first thing that comes to us is fear. We start to fear what will happen to us. In that case, don't fear. You know, depend upon the Lord. Depend upon the Lord. Wait for him. Okay, I am here. I'm hungry. I'm in pain. But don't get affected by pain. Wait for him to appear and remove your pain. So, you know, that needs a lot of courage. If you get scared, then you cannot do that. So he said, a person who does not fear at all. Fear of the situations that we face. Be it raga, bhaya, krodha, and a person who does not get angry, agitated. You know, I am in a difficult situation, I'm in a wrong situation, and I get angry. I said, no, don't get angry. Just know that this is the will of Lord. The Lord wants to show his face to you. Just see this as an opportunity. It's very difficult. When it happens to me, you know, the first reaction most of the time is anger. But then when I control myself, I see that I can see the Lord, the hand of the divine. So if you can control yourself, if you cannot be agitated by any situation, and man mana ma mupashrita, a person whose mind dwells in me, his mind does not dwell in this universe, in this world. A person whose mind dwells in me, man mana, and ma mupashrita, and a person who completely depends on me. Just like a child, you know. Just like a child. He's helpless. He can only cry, that's all. He can only cry and call his mother, that's all. He cannot do anything. He's having stomach pain. He's hungry. He cannot sleep. Whatever it is, he cannot say anything. He only cries, ma, ma. He just calls his mother, that's all. He doesn't go for to get a medicine.
Hey, Swamiji, you're muted. We can't hear you.
Yeah, sorry, I got disconnected.
That's right. That's entertaining everyone.
So it says that bita raga bhaya krodha man mana. Can you hear me? Hello, can you hear me? Okay, so man mana mamupashrita means one who depends upon me. He does not depend upon anything. You know, if I'm hungry, the child doesn't go for food. He just calls his mother. He's helpless. In that way, we need to be helpless. You know, we need to depend on God. You don't try to, you know, rescue yourself. Don't try to rescue yourself. There's something in spiritual world, it's called titiksha. Titiksha means, you know, there are three kinds of sufferings that we face. The one is from the nature. That is called adi bhautik. Like, you know, like we have floods, we have droughts, you know, we have tsunami, earthquake. So these are the sufferings that are caused through nature. Then there are some sufferings which are caused through destiny. Like, you know, my house got caught in fire. My father died. I love a friend and that friend, you know, betrayed me. You know, where it is beyond my control. When situations are beyond my control, you know, they're controlled by the destiny. So these are the things, you know, like now coronavirus. Nobody, you know, we didn't create coronavirus. It was just imposed on us, and the whole world is, you know, suffering now. You know, here in Varanasi, we see so many people dying, you know. Many people, like every day in our locality, in this particular place where we live, like every day there are 5-6 people who are dying every day. Every day their houses are getting sealed, you know, hotspot is created. So this situation is very difficult and very, like, dangerous. And we have been imposed upon, you know, these situations are imposed upon us. So this was not our creation. So, you know, the sufferings which are caused by the divine, you know, by destiny. And there are some sufferings which are caused by our body and our mind. So there are three kinds of suffering: adi daivik, adi bhautik, and adhyatmik. And that is why you see that when we talk about, when we chant mantras, we say Om Shanti Shanti, Shanti, three times. Why do we say three times? It's because we make to, have peace in these three kinds of sufferings. Okay, so titiksha means, when you will suffer, when the sufferings will be imposed to you, you should not try to rescue yourself. Just depend upon God. Just depend upon God and let Him rescue you. You don't need to rescue yourself. And if you can do this, you will see that you will have enormous power. You will have enormous power. You will have enormous energy, enormous knowledge. So here also he says, "Be the raga bhaya krodha man mana maam upashrita." A person who is completely dependent upon me. He does not rescue himself. He does not put an effort to get out of any situation. He waits for me. He depends on me so that I come and I rescue him from that given situation. Ita raga bhaya krodha man mana maam upashrita bahavo gyana tapasa. And a person who to reach me, he performs austerity in many, many knowledges, in many, many ways, just to reach me. He tries many ways, many knowledges, just to reach me. Bita raga bhaya krodha man mana maam upashrita bahavo gyana tapasa. Just to reach me, he tries different ways, but his intention is to reach me. Puta means pure. A person who is completely pure, who does not have any, pure means a person who has, full synchronicity in his mind and his speech. That person is pure. If you have something in your mind and something in your speech, you are impure. You are considered to be impure. Purity means whatever it is there in your mind, it should be there in your speech. So this kind of person, who are not hypocrites at all. So Bhitaraga Bhaya Krodha Man Mana Maam Upashrita Bhavo Gyana Tapasa Puta Mad Bhavo Ma Gataha. These are the person who attains my divine being, who attains my divine, form, my divine being. So today we have to stop here. Okay. So next Monday we're going to talk about it more. So it has been very good, this particular chapter. It was really good because I also, while speaking, many things became clear to me. And it's very good that when I talk to you, or everybody, I can see you, your faces, and that brings the best out of me. I can feel this, and I feel such a great love for God, and such a nearness to God, and it's also very good for me. Thank you very much for giving this opportunity.
Thank you,
Swamiji.
And we love you too.
Swamiji, Tapan Ghosh.
Huh?
Hello.